All right.
They do that slow, and I told y'all last night you need to do it tonight. What was it? I think Dale was singing, wasn't he? Right.
What was it?
Yeah, it was real pretty. I had a good, like a dream dream.
Thanks. Hello, everybody. This is Jimmy. It's January the 6th, 2021, and we're over here at Macedonia Baptist Church again. And we're going to be recording the entire show tonight, so I hope you get a blessing out of it. Every Wednesday night, they're going to be having gospel singers over here in groups. So y'all tune in. Just go to YouTube, enter my name, or else enter. Macedonia Baptist Church. Either way, you can see the video.
Anyone?
Yeah, you got time.
I want you to hear this one.
We got Wait a minute, we got a good singer over here, man.
Let's see. 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 Let's Problem in the world today. Is the limit of singing, the limit of worship.
y'all ready to start?
Wayne, go open this up.
Ron, go ahead and open a prayer tonight, and we'll go ahead and get it started. We got a lengthy, little lengthy program tonight.
Right.
With David Earl Lawson with us, too. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you in the precious name of Jesus tonight. We thank you for the ones that come out, for the singers, and the anointing that you're going to give to us, Father. Please come and meet with us, Father. We need it, Father. We need a touch of heaven tonight. Father, as I briefly open up the bread of life and these singers come and pour their hearts out, Father, I pray the Holy Spirit will use them to go through the hearts of these pews, Father, to touch souls, Father. Oh, we need a touch from you, Father. I'm begging for you to meet with us tonight. Use me for your glory. Use the singers for your glory, Father. As I pray tonight, God, on this nation of ours that's going through stress and duress right now, Father, we don't know the reasons why you're allowing this to happen, but I know you're still in control. Father, I know that your ways are not our ways, Father. I know, Father, that you said that where two or three are gathered, that you're here in the midst of them. Hear the cries of your children, Father. You said in your word, those that are heavy laden, that you would give them rest. Father, there's a lot of preachers right now, pastors all over the world that are heavy laden. Father, your praying church is hurt right now. Your voice of the church has been silent, Father. In the name of Jesus, I pray, when is judgment going to come for the wicked, Father? Father, I pray that you'll open this presidency and overturn it, Father, in the name of Jesus, Father. Father, I pray you'll restore the faith in your prophets, Father, that have been discredited, Father. Not a single prophet prophesied that Biden would win, Father. Not one. Father, I know that your ways are not always, Father. I pray, Father, that you'll restore justice for the crimes that have been committed. For the fraud in this election, overwhelm fraud, Heavenly Father. And on video, people moving the votes and recounting them. Blatant this disregard for the law. Not one of them have been prosecuted and brought to justice. The crooked FBI, the crooked politicians, not one, Father, has gone to jail. Father, I pray you said in your word, vengeance is yours, saith the Lord. Yes. Father, I pray that you'll bring vengeance and show that they can't break the law and get away with it. They can't silence your church, Father, and get away with it. Father, I'm praying that you'll get the victory, Father. Yes. Show us your mighty power. Bring the voice back into your church. We've been censored with our speech, Father. The devil is reigning over this world, Father. And enough is enough, Father. I pray that you'll restore this church and the voice that's coming, Father. I ask these things in the precious name of Jesus.
Amen.
As I open up, Father, I had a program right now. I had a mini 15-minute sermon. You know, I throw that all away. Holy Ghost is on me. I don't need no program to preach what I got to preach in 15 minutes, Father. But I'm telling you, right now, what's happening in this country, in our nation, with the riots in the Capitol, disturbing the hearings to rip our president back, a lot of turmoil is in this country right now, folks. A lot of turmoil. And some of the reasons why, judgment has fallen on America.
Yes.
Judgment has fallen on America.
Right.
It has to be very serious for great God Almighty to go against his Bible preaching prophets. Every one of them prophesied that Trump would win.
Come on.
Every one of them, not one single one prophesied that Biden wins. The praying church all over the world is being not answered. We don't know the reasons why our Heavenly Father is putting an ungodly person in office. His ways are not our ways.
Come on.
I'll tell you, folks, I have theories that I still believe with all my heart. And a lot of pastors have given up. Oh, Biden's got it. Shame on you, ye of little faith. And stench in the nostril of God for every man of God that don't believe that God can overturn this election. I believe he can. We got till January 20th. I believe it all in my heart he can. The disciples were in the boat, and what did Jesus say to them? Master, do you care if we perish? Oh, ye of little faith. He wasn't talking to the church member. He was talking to the disciples, the elite of that day, the men of God of that day. Oh, ye of little faith. Our men of God today have little faith. And wonder why God judges America
Somebody had said that 40% of the Christians voted for Biden. Can you believe that? 40%? I hardly believe that number. And if that's true, no wonder judgment has fallen on America. To me, they're not truly born-again believers. You're led and fed by the Spirit of God. You would not vote for an ungodly person that wants to kill babies now that the baby is born and then murdered. Oh, and let alone this LGBT movement, these gays all over. God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. America has not repented. He sent the plague of AIDS, and they still haven't repented. Just a few days ago, they answered a White House prayer. Instead of saying amen, he said amen and a woman. What is the world coming to? To appease the gays? Oh, so much ungodliness in this country. Why has it happened, folks? I'll tell you why it's happened. I was dealing this with my quiet time, but the precious Heavenly Father, and me and amongst other pastors, we couldn't figure out why is all these things happening. It just doesn't make any sense for God to go against His praying church, His prophets. Why are these things happening? We just cannot figure it out. The Lord showed me, and my theory behind it, if God don't restore President Trump back in office, my theory behind it, if he don't, my reasons are in preparation for the rapture of the church, folks. In preparation for the rapture of the church. Because his ways are not our ways. It has to be very important for him to go against his prophets and his praying church for allow this ungodly man to be, unless he has other reasons. But you know what the Lord told me, not in an audio voice? He told me in the thought spirit, why are you so upset with me? He said, you should be happy I'm getting ready to rapture the church. You should be glad that I'm coming back. And the Lord is right. The Lord put it on my heart to tell you this tonight. We have on a limited timetable. We should be happy. I can't wait to get to heaven, get out of this stinking world. But the Lord told me the problem with the world today is they're more in love with the world and their families than they are with me. You want to know why judgment has fallen on America? And forgive me, Pastor, I don't want to offend any man of God in here, but I got to preach what's on my heart. Long before this epidemic came, long before it came, these churches have been shutting down. Every holiday, canceling the evening service. Every holiday, Christmas, Father's Day, News Day, cancel the evening services. Be with your families. Let me tell you something about our Heavenly Father. He's a very jealous guy.
Yes, he is.
And I'm guilty of it. Just like everyone in these pews. I'm preaching to me. I'm guilty of it. I put my family first before God. Okay? Let me ask you, everyone who's in here, okay, everyone who's in here, did anyone in your family die for you? Did anyone in your family take a beating on the cross beyond recognition? Did anyone in your family die for you?
No.
Our Heavenly Father did.
Yes.
But why, on every holiday, we want to be with our families? We want to stuff our guts, our meals, and our holidays. It's more important to be with your family than come into the house of God and be fed. These pastors, shame on them. Every one of them that shut the house of God down, canceled the evening services for a holiday. Did my precious word not tell you, pastors, Romans 12, 1 and 3, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto Him. Be not conformed to the things of this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yes.
Let me tell you something, preachers and pastors that cancel the evening services. How many minds did you transform? How many minds did you renew when you shut the house of God down?
Oh.
It's a stench in the nostrils of God to every one of y'all. They cancel the evening service every holiday. You want to know why judgment is falling on America? That's one of the doggone reasons why. You don't feed the flock. There's a whole chapter in Ezekiel 34. Talks about being about the business. Feeding the flock.
Yes.
Feeding the sheep. When the house of God is shut down, the sheep are not being fed. The devil is like a roaring lion coming in to grab the flock. When they're not being fed, what do you think is happening when you cancel the evening services? It's a stench in the nostrils of God for a pastor that does that. And he will face judgment on God Almighty.
Come on, brother.
They're going to open up the windows of hell. God's going to open up the gates of hell. And he's going to see, preacher, in my house there are many mansions. I could have held you at a higher part of heaven. But old preacher, pastor, I'm going to hold you down at the lowest. And I want to show you something, preacher, so-called man of God. And he opens up the gates of hell, and the weeping and the wailing, and the gnashing of the teeth, and the screaming of tortured souls.
Come on.
He said a lot of people are down there because of you. You didn't honor the Sabbath like my precious word told you to.
Amen.
You didn't honor the Sabbath. You didn't feed my flock. Did I not anoint certain people to be apostles, teachers, evangelists, the fivefold ministry? Did I not give them spiritual gifts? Did I not give you a household of information to preach to the flock? And you have the audacity to shut my house down on a holiday and put your family above me? Shame on you!
Come on, brother.
Shame on the church members that do the exact same thing. Oh, it's a holiday. I'm not going to go to church. I got company coming over. Why don't you invite them to church to let them get fed? And you wonder why you don't have the blessings of God in the churches? Don't feel the Spirit like they could? Jesus is looking up with an eye. And there are very few churches, folks, that are open every holiday. My former church, I'll be proud to say, Gethsemane Baptist Temple, never shuts the house of God down. God don't mind a pastor being home with his family, folks, his loved ones. He's entitled to take a day off during the holiday, but he's not entitled to shut the house of God down. You have somebody else fill the pulpit to preach the word. Since we've started this Wednesday night, me and Brother Wayne here, secretly unbeknownst to our pastor, we prayed that it would open. This church wasn't open up Wednesday nights. Since we've opened it up, God answered prayer. We've had more blessings and spiritual-filled moments. These Wednesday night singings, we've been overbooked. That's a move of God. It's the spirit of the God manifestation here. Why? Because he opened up and answered prayer. He opened the house of God up. A lot of problems with your preachers today. The reason they cancel the evening services and they don't have somebody fill in for them is self-righteousness. They think I'm so doggone good that they can't preach the word as good as me. I'm not going to share my pulpit. Shame on them.
Come on.
They're so self-righteous. They have egos.
Come on.
Shame on them. There's a lot of young preachers coming up that need a platform to preach. They're just opening for the doors to come. But these house of gods are canceling the evening services every holiday. Jesus is looking down on them, you know. They're shutting my house, God, down with tears in his eyes, knowing they're going to go to hell because they ain't preached to. That pastor, he's so disappointed in him. The holy, the Sabbath day, to keep it holy. They've forgotten what holiness is. Canceling the evening services. They've forgotten what holiness is, ladies and gentlemen. I take it to the members. We are the same situation when we don't go to the house of God. Granted, you can't go every Sunday, and I'm not talking about that. But he requires a personal relationship with him. And if you honor the Sabbath like he tells you to in that word, you'll be much more blessed and have the favor of God. But Jesus is looking down on the earth, and he's looking and says, wow, that church is open. Maybe I'll just show down in manifestation of the Holy Spirit and make my presence known. You think he's going to make his presence known to a pastor that shuts down the house of God? I hardly think so, folks. I hardly think so. But in closing, judgment has come on America. Okay, my last few minutes here, this is my last theory. President Trump established peace in the Middle East. That's never been done before. In preparation for the rapture of the church, folks, I believe that if Biden gets put in there, it's in preparation for the rapture of the church.
That's right.
Because the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period, there will be peace on earth, no wars. So that Satan will be ushered in the Antichrist, so they'll believe in him. Trump has already set the peace in the Middle East. That's never been done before. The stage is being set. The Democrats get put in office, it's going to be socialist government. The mark of the beast takes place in here. Rapture of the church cannot buy or sell without receiving the mark. When a social government comes in, they've already took over our speech. They're going to come for your guns next. They're going to control every facet of your life. In preparation, you cannot buy or sell without receiving the mark. Think about that, folks. Rapture of the church. And the Lord told me to preach this, that, hey, you should be happy I'm getting ready to rapture it out. Now, what are you going to do with it with the few minutes you got left of your life? Minister to every loved one you got, telling them that the rapture of your church is imminent. To get right before it's too late, folks. Get right before it's too late. And I'm going to close with that. I ask that all of y'all get right. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus.
You got
amen.
Any more minutes? You got any more minutes?
No.
Well, he gave me the signal. I wanted to go, okay. But you know.
I thought you had 15 minutes.
Well, the devil interferes, but that's all right.
That was great. I love it. That was good. We got a few extra songs tonight, and, you know, I thought we'd Ron did cut it short, and but he still got to bring the Word of God out to people. We appreciate that. And Ron, we appreciate what you do for the Lord and bringing it to the service tonight. And the singers, the Rocky River Band's here tonight.
Right.
And then Jimmy Gilstrap, one of the members, he's back here on the camera.
That was great.
And I appreciate
that. All right.
I appreciate the message tonight, Ron. It touched a lot of hearts. I know it touched mine. We do need to go where the Lord leads us to go and be there when He wants us to be there and serve Him. Just the only thing that Ron really wanted everybody to do is to go when God calls you and do the will of God. That's what Ron was preaching tonight, being in the will of God. Appreciate that one coming. Thank you.
All
right. I don't think the ladies of prayer that gave food to me, that was good. I think I gained 4 pounds. Now I weigh 200.
We're going to put the devil in the funnel booth.
Amen.
Clap your hands if you want to stand up. I'll tell you what, we're not afraid to see you just dance all over the place. Amen.
Jack Daniel's whiskey to get me high. I don't need no happy hours, cause all my hours are happy since I let Jesus have control of my life. And if I have a habit, It's gonna be Jesus. And if I have a hang-up, I'm gonna hang on to him. And if I wanna get high, well, I'll leave that to God's Spirit. He takes me to heights that I've never been, and he never lets me down. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. Well, God don't care how good you two-step with the ladies and all the cold beer you can drink won't wash your sin away. All the nightlife, not the good life, you've wasted your life seeking. Oh, friend Jesus, yes, Jesus is the only way. And if I have a habit, it's gonna be Jesus. And if I have a hang-up, I'm gonna hang on to him. And if I wanna get high, I'll leave that to God's Spirit. He takes me to heights that I've never been, and he never lets me down. Oh no, no. He takes me to heights that I've never been, and he never lets me down. Oh, yeah. Oh, God bless you. You know what?
Hallelujah.
The Bible said, be not drunk with wine.
That's right.
In excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. It's all right with God to get drunk on the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'm going to tell you something. When I go in a church or a place of worship, if I sit there quiet, then I'm sinning. Because back before I got born again, and I went in them honky-tonks, I had to holler and let them know I was in there.
That's right.
Now, my personality is the same, but my personality got saved too. I'm still me. Amen.
Yeah, come on.
And I tell you what, I like to have fun with God's people. And ain't nothing wrong with it.
That's right.
Praise God. And I don't care who you are, where you been, God made you like he made you.
Come on.
And I think about some of the things I used to do.
Yes.
And everywhere I ever been, in whatever circumstance I was in, people there that loved the Lord too.
Come on.
I used to ride them bucking bulls and horses. And I loved being a cowboy. I watched them movies. I wanted to be just like them. But I'm going to tell you something. I knew cowboys that was married and had their family and their kids with them, and they didn't partake of everything that's stereotyped. And I'm going to tell you something. God loves you just like you are. He just wants you to live for him. Amen.
That's right. Amen, brother.
I grew up on a straw horse with a cap gun in my hand. In his mind he must have thought every outlaw in the land. And when he turned 18, he joined the rodeo. He went from town to town, breaking horses and bones. He must have won 1,000 trophies. Some say he was the best. He rode every bronc that ever came out of the West. His body bore the scars. It was a price he had to pay. So he started drinking whiskey. Said it helped to ease the pain. And then one night in Okie City, he found the Bible by his bed. John 3:16 had been underlined in red. And in that little rundown motel, he met someone who turned his life around. Now he's rescued more cowboys than all the rodeo clan. Lord, he could ride them all. He would lend a helping hand when some cowboy take a fall. Well, he rode the rodeo circuit, Calgary down to Galveston. Yeah, he led cowboys to Jesus, and that's how the West was won. Well, they called him Rodeo Preacher. Lord, he could ride them all. He would lend a helping hand when some cowboy take a fall. Well, he Calgary down to Galveston. Yeah, he led cowboys to Jesus, and that's how the West was won. Yeah, he led cowboys to Jesus, and that's how the West was won. Amen. That's the truth. Amen.
Yeah.
I love that song because it doesn't matter where you are. Where you are is where you're supposed to be.
That's right.
Because if it wasn't, God would move you.
That's right.
We just need to bloom where we at. Amen. Now, I love this song right here, and I hope you do too, because it keeps, to me, it keeps it real. Amen.
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Down the street, I was sitting in the congregation. I was listening to the preacher preach. Yeah, we had a good time. Love all over the place. We was talking about the blood of Jesus and singing Amazing Grace. Gave a little money, all I could afford. And then me and my brothers and sisters got on down to praising the Lord. Yeah, we had a good time thinking about the promised land. And when I got home Sunday morning, I was feeling like a brand new man. Monday morning, my car wouldn't start. I didn't get to work until 10. The boss man said, if you want to work here, don't you ever let it happen again. There was people grumbling and carrying on. I had to listen to all that fuss. I tell you, brother, it's just about enough to make a man want to cuss. I went over to the corner where there wasn't nobody but me. I said, thank you, Jesus, because I'm not the man I used to be. I'm gonna make it. I make it through the week because I know. Come Sunday morning, I'll be sitting on the very front row. Saturday evening, friend came by. He said, come on, let's go downtown. We'll find us a bar and we'll pick up some girls and we'll go fooling around. I said, hold on, buddy. I'm sure glad you came, cause I got something I want you to see. Why don't you sit down here and let me tell you about what the Lord has done for me. I said, Jesus loves you, and he died for your sins. And if you let me, I'll be glad to lead you straight to him. We talked for a little while, then we got down on our knees. Now Sunday morning, every Sunday morning, every Sunday morning, he's sitting right here with me in the very front row. Hey, man, I tell you what, I ain't a preacher and I ain't a judge, just a witness. Man, what a great calling. Everybody loves Jesus. He turns us into a witness. I can't quote a whole lot of scripture, but I can tell you what Jesus has done for me.
Amen, brother.
Now, buddy, you're looking at a man that the fires of hell was about to get so many times. But Jesus, he loves a knuckle hardhead.
Amen, brother.
He loves everybody. Yes, amen. Amen. And I'm going to tell you what, this is where it all started, though. I think somebody said something about pride.
Come on. Amen, brother.
Boy, I tell you, I watch them John Wayne movies, and I was a prideful man, you know, wanting to be tough. Till I got by myself, away from everybody, and then I crying like a little baby, wondering why it's the doggone hurt. Anybody else ever been like that? Oh, boy, and then I'd get around somebody, wipe my face off, and I'd act tough.
You feel like you're 10 foot tall, bulletproof.
How foolish. But life started when I just humbled myself and asked God to help me. Just ask him to help me. And he did. And he does every day. Lord, help me walk another mile, one more mile. I'm tired of walking all alone, Lord, help me smile, another smile, one more smile.
Amen.
I'm tired of walking on my own. I thought that I could make it by myself.
Oh, by myself.
Now I know that I can't take it anymore.
Yeah.
I can't take it. With a humble heart and on bending knees, I'm begging you, please help me. Help me.
Yes.
Come down from your great white throne to me, to lowly me.
Yes.
I need to feel the touch of your nail-scarred hand.
Yes.
Lord, remove these chains of darkness and let me see. Oh, let me see where I fit into your master plan. Oh, I never thought that I needed your help before. I didn't think I needed you, Jesus. I thought that I could make it by myself.
Oh, by myself.
Now I know that I can't take it anymore. I can't take it with a humble heart and on bending knees. I'm begging you, please help me. Please help me.
Amen.
Ain't it the truth? Ain't it the truth?
Yes.
But I tell you what, I don't know why it's so hard. I don't know why it's so hard. And then when we get saved and we get in the light, we look back and say, I don't know why I thought it was so hard. God loves us so much,
yes, she does,
that he makes it easy.
That's right.
It's hard to fight against him.
Go ahead.
It don't matter where you've been. It matters where you're at and where you're going. Amen.
Amen.
It don't matter where you've been. It don't matter what you've lost. It don't matter how you've seen. It don't matter what it's cost. It don't matter anymore. That old life you lived in sin, you're still loved by the Lord. It don't matter where you've been.
Amen.
I've been down the road that's full of sin for the soul, and I've hung my head in shame when sin left me holding the blame. When I found grace at Calvary, my blinded eyes began to see. You don't have to live in sin. It don't matter where you've been. Have you given up on hope? Have you failed and lost your way? Now with life, you just can't cope. God has a plan for you today. You can leave it all behind. Then your new life will find. Just look to him and you will see. It don't matter where you've been. You see, I've been down the road that's full of pain for the soul, and I've hung my head in shame when sin left me holding the blame. When I found grace at Calvary, my blinded eyes began to see. You can walk away from sin. It don't matter where you've been. Your broken life, he still can mend. It don't matter where you've been. Boy, if that ain't good news, I don't know what is. Amen.
Amen.
Because every one of us has blowed it, haven't we?
Come on,
oh, yeah.
I can handle the ones I blowed before I got saved. You know, I thank God I'm under the blood, but it's hard sometimes, you know, when you, I know better. And I still get ambushed.
That's right.
And I can't give Satan all the credit. Sometimes it's just a man I see in the mirror.
That's right, brother.
We need him every day. Yes. Amen. Every day. And I'm glad that God adopted me.
Amen.
I know a little bit about adoption. I got two of my oldest kids that's adopted. And I'm going to tell you something. When God, when we think out, call out, whisper out, cry out to God, and say, help me. He means business. When he hears that,
come on. Mm-hmm.
It's amazing how much work he does. Amen. He does the work.
That's right.
We can't do it.
Amen, bro.
That's what gets me. We
Amen.
Can't do it.
That's right, bro.
I'm going to shut up and sing. But I'm blessed. I'm telling you what, I'm blessed.
Yes, we are.
And I know you are too. And I know you know it. But don't it feel good to rub elbows with other people that know
Amen.
You're blessed? I tell you what, sometimes you ever sing somebody and you say, oh, Lord, here they come. Ain't nothing good. It's talking about bad. But I'm going to tell you something. It's fun when you rub elbows with people that knows they're blessed too. Amen.
Oh, yeah.
It sure is good to be saved. He goes above and beyond with everything he does. I've never made a fortune. It's probably too late now. Oh, but I don't worry about that much. Cause I'm happy anyhow. As I go along life's journey, I'm reaping better than I sow. I'm drinking from my saucer, cause my cup has overflowed. I ain't got a lot of riches. Sometimes the going's rough.